potato.
Good morning and welcome to Stop Making Money, Valuation and Non-Monetary Utopias, or let's see if they're more than utopias. It's a session with Stefan Heidenreich and Rachel O'Dwyer, and it's part of a series of events here at Transmediale Face Value, which we kind of internally developed as so-called unmoderated conversations. It sounds like they will be very candid as you can get about this topic. But much more than that, it's really an occasion for two theorists, thinkers, practitioners to engage with each other's thought in a format which is not like the usual paper presentation, but more of a free-flowing stream of associations and references. And today then, we have two theorists, writers, practitioners that engage with questions of economy, art, and technology, especially concerning also, of course, new ways of organizing these entities. So Stefan's work on money, for example, his work together with his brother Ralf Heidenreich, they have presented also here at the festival in the past. The work that they've done and has included the books Mehr Geld from 2008 and Forderungen 2015, both on Merve-Flag. Stefan just published, also on Merve, Geld für eine non-monetäre Ökonomie. And that would be, I guess, money towards a non-monetary economy. And I would like to note that we translated excerpts of this, and you can find them in the Transmediale journal. Well, that you can buy here at the festival for almost no geld, actually, €3. It's important to note that in the title of Stefan's book, the geld is crossed over. So, yeah. And this is part of the topics, of course, moneyless and alternative money futures, including topics such as cryptocurrencies and algorithmic governance. That will be discussed here today. That's something that Rachel O'Dwyer has dealt with in depth, for example, by considering blockchain as a new form of kind of automated governance, but also considering the political implications of that. She has recently contributed to a number of publications on such topics, including Artists Rethinking the Blockchain, as featured previously here at the festival, Paid, coming out on MIT Press, and Ours to Hack and to Own on OR Books in 2016. She's also the leader of the Dublin Art and Technology Association, data and curator of the festival and conference Open Here. And I think what unites O'Dwyer and Heidenreich's work, and maybe you'll also explore important differences, is really trying to go beyond the hype of these technological frameworks that are discussed and how they're connected to economies, but also really trying to be constructive about it and come up with new models. So please welcome the two speakers.
Hi, good morning. When Stefan and I were talking about how to organize the conversation format, I think we were both thinking about times when we'd seen conversation formats crash and burn in other contexts and the ways in which they can sometimes be a bit awkward, or there can be imbalances as well in the conversation, where maybe one of you falls into sort of an interview role and the other doesn't. So what we decided is maybe that while we want to use this interview process a little bit, that we're going to sort of switch around a bit. So I want to maybe ask Stefan some questions specifically about the non-monetary economy ideas that he's developed in his recent book. And then he's going to push me on some of the work, particularly I've been doing on cash and cashless societies, and also new kinds of data extractivism or transactional data valence that we're seeing around the emergence of digital payments. And I came to Stefan's work first in the very first Money Lab board organized by Institute of Network Cultures, and I was really, really blown away by some of the work that you were presenting there, and particularly the idea of this kind of matching algorithm, which hopefully we're going to try and tease out today. But I felt after reading, particularly, possibly this is because I'm reading only the translated excerpts, unfortunately, because I don't read German. So for me, I felt my first question after reading the work is, what is your understanding of money, Stefan? I know this is a bit of a black hole, but kind of maybe there's some key principles about money that you want to extract. Yeah.
Well, as Christopher rightfully said, there's a strike through the money. So ultimately, I want to get rid of it altogether. And I think that's it's so to say within technical reach, because if you think of economy, can we have the other screen, because there's one technical thing that I would right. So we're going to have the 15 minutes interview situations, vice versa. But in case you come up with questions in the meantime, we may react to it, depending on what. But we can just put them on the other pad that you see on the right hand side, which is the etherpad.net/p/TM questions. So if any topics or whatever you want to know comes up, just put it there. It's like a kind of Twitter wall, just that it's an etherpad. Okay. And then we're not going to react immediately, but just to give it a bit more, so to say, echo space, the whole thing. So about money, I'm not going to try to explain what I think money is and others think money is. That's not so much, but in the more interesting perspective is the one from a media historical, not so much economy perspective. And from a media historical perspective, it was pretty much David Graeber's book on 5,000 Years of Debt that brought me to the idea that there was an economy before money, and it depended on notation systems. It first depended on memory. We're going to come back to that thing. It first depended on memory, then you had notation systems, and then only afterwards there was money entering the whole thing. And now if you look at the technical situation that we have these days, it's clear that we again have notation systems at our disposal that we can use, no? Which is the internet, the computers and whatnot. So we again have notation systems that can track all transactions. And that opens the space to think about, once we can calculate, we can track all transactions, we can calculate all transactions, there is a space to organize what the economy does without money. Because the economy is about distribution allocation. Let's face it, no? So we distribute things, we allocate work, we do things for each other. All that can be tracked, is being tracked already now. And that opens the possibility that we can think of, let's say, distribution systems that operate without money, but through algorithms, artificial intelligence, or whatnot. And it's just I'm not going that much further. I don't know how exactly that works. But the space to try to think it and to try to figure out what political implications and what kind of economic implications are there, the space is open, not since long, but basically since now. And when you talk about economy, the money thing seems to be something hardwired. We need money because everything needs to have a price. Blah blah blah. The bit philosophical question behind it, do we need money is one question. The other question is, do we need any kind of substitute money? Do we need a general equivalent? Does one thing need to have one value? And I don't think so.
So if I understand it, I'm going to fall back just quickly into a kind of a contested understanding of money specifically because I think maybe it's useful to what you just said. So you might be familiar with a very classical economic understanding of money as being a means of exchange, a unit of account, and a store of value. If I understand, the aspect that you maybe feel is most problematic is this unit of account. It's the system in which things are being evaluated in relation to each other. Use the Marxist term general equivalent, but is that...
The most problematic aspect, as we all know, is the storing value aspect, and that is actually that's the unfortunate thing that we have to measure value and store. That's the classical thing. The storing is the problem, because the storing creates the, so to say, the material. I could almost say not really material. No, the media basis for the horrendous inequality that is happening in our world, because actually the monetary system that we have is a tribute system. With every interaction that we do, we pay a little tribute, and it doesn't trickle down. No? That's what they tried to say us for a long, long time. No, it doesn't trickle down. So we have money as an inherent tendency in money to create the inequalities that we're faced with in our world. And that's, so to say, this small revolutionary core of the whole thing. Of course, with an algorithmic system that only tries to manage distributions, the hoarding is... I'm sure they find ways to get it done, but it's not that easy, maybe. It doesn't come natural, let's say.
So it's not so much the kind of making equivalences between things then that you feel is problematic, it's the fact that you can use it as a store of wealth. So maybe do you feel that with the matching algorithm, so you spend quite a lot of the excerpt that I was able to read, and actually quite a lot of the work that you did in Money Lab, talking about this idea of the matching algorithm as being a sort of a post-monetary form of value exchange. And so you feel like that's something then that potentially, even though it's a form of keeping account, it's one in which you somehow can't store or you can't hoard value, that value has to be recircululated.
Yeah, because there is no value in a traditional sense. I mean, the matching is just the, so to say, the programmer's equivalent to the function that you need to perform. We have very many things, and there's many people, and things need to be distributed somehow. That's called matching. That's, so to say, the procedure that is needed. And if you just match things, then you also don't really have ownership. That's actually something that I learned from Graeber, because in the early, like, say, the early societies, you didn't have that, how to say, insistence, and they weren't insisting on ownership that way. You have to use the house, you have to use the car, but it's not about owning it. Actually, the idea is that the house, let's keep the house, because the house is a nice example. House is also, Greek means oikos, so the house is also at the beginning of everything that we think about economy. Economy means the law of the house. So let's take the house. The house provides space. Space needs to be matched. We're having a matching situation here. We have this talk and that space. The talk is matched to the space. It's a classical matching thing. That can be also done for other spaces. You don't need to own a space in order to... The space doesn't need an owner to be matched. That also means, on the other hand, that, so to say, the house, let's say the house is an intelligent agent by itself, can be responsible of the matching. Okay, just to add one thing, I know that lots of things can go wrong with that matching, and actually we also witnessed that, so to say, with all those hopes that you put in technical systems, they produce their mistakes, and the mistakes can be terrible. Deal, no? But still, it's a matter of political agenda to develop. Okay, there is that possibility, and we will have to face it. It's coming our way already now, and we will have to find a political solution, no matter how bad the algorithms are.
So would examples of these matching algorithms, you're saying that they already exist, so would they be things like, I think there are certain matching algorithms for people who are donating organs, for example. So you might want to give a kidney to somebody, mm-hmm. but it's not necessarily the person, you know, that if you're a spouse or somebody, you can donate a kidney to get a kidney for your...
It's actually a great example, because that is something exempt from economic transactions. You don't sell your organs, except you're living in Moldova, and the capitalist, the situation is that dire that people try to squeeze you into that, but it's a classical example where you say there a matching system replaces, rightfully so, an economic matching, a money-based matching. Because with money we also perform matchings, but just not moneyless matchings.
So it's but you feel that it's not economic. But I guess what I'm wondering is, the matching system still sort of keeps some sort of an account.
Right.
Yeah.
Has to.
And how, I guess, yeah, from my understanding of reading again your work, you talked quite a lot about how most transactions that we see are, I suppose, they're synchronous or they're two-way, that I give you money for a coffee or whatever, and that maybe in a matching algorithm, to go back to the kidney example, that I give my kidney to somebody else to get a kidney or maybe another organ, say for my husband, that these aren't, that these are maybe deferred or they're asynchronous. But is there still sort of some accountability still happening? So there's still, as you mentioned, a tribute or a debt being produced within the matching algorithm.
Yeah, okay, things get tricky pretty quickly. When it's clear that we're not talking about systems that avoid to hand in data. It's clearly that this can only work in a data-rich environment. In order to perform the matching, one basically has to know the economic history of the... it's almost like blockchain. That's actually one of the application fields where you could use blockchain for the whole thing, to track an economic history. And it's also there, the systems are kind of already coming. If you look at the credit history, things in the United States, where credit is handled on a totally different basis than here. That's also, so to say, the history of economic transactions is turned into matching already now. We're not talking about completely futuristic systems, but we're talking about a recombination of existing things. And then of course you have the data problem, how to handle the data and how to guarantee that an amount of privacy, how to deal with hacking, how to deal with all kind of obstructions that this system creates incentives to do. I know that it's clear that there's lots of problems coming with us with an idea of that type. That's obvious, no? But still, as it's coming, it's not our choice to have it or not. It's coming our way anyhow. You did quite a bit of work on the on the Chinese and on other credit systems. So we started talking about that yesterday, but when the topic was far from exhausted. If you can, maybe you can show some examples of that. That would be great.
I guess. Could I possibly have my screen, which is the other laptop? Yeah. So, I guess my instinct on reading the work around this theory of matching algorithms was that our post-monetary economy is already here, but it's far from utopian. So increasingly, we're seeing pushes towards the removal of cash, for example, so cashless economies. In 2016, there was a massive kind of demonetization push in India. There's various forms of kind of national digital payment systems, such as Union Pay in China. So a push by governments on one hand towards moving away from anonymous sort of bearer instruments that can circulate within an economy towards digital payments, but also that as we're all already familiar with, we're seeing kind of increasingly different kinds of information and communication platforms emerging as the new banks. So in some ways, the Global North seems to have driven this particular model in that early iterations or examples of this were things like M-Pesa, where initially people were using airtime or phone credit as forms of remittance, and then that kind of developed into a better articulated mobile payment system. But obviously today, increasingly, there are all sorts of different kinds of platforms that are blending, I suppose, aspects of social media and communications with the transfer of money. So companies that were previously the rails for communications or data are increasingly now the rails for cash. An example maybe that I've been hearing a lot about at the moment would be something like WePay in China. The rhetoric is that it's going to make cash in Shanghai obsolete very, very quickly because people are increasingly using it and using it for all sorts of kinds of payments and all sorts of kind of social interactions with money, so that you can send monetary gifts to people, you can do quite playful things, and that you can randomize the payments that you're sending to among your friends, or you can send gifts for New Year or for graduations, for example. So a lot of these companies have legacies in, as I said, social media or in gaming. So WePay, for example, the developers of WePay are trying to gamify money in some ways. So creating kind of new sorts of ways of people interacting with digital payments. Obviously then, you know, we've seen similar things with Venmo. Now, personally, I haven't used Venmo because it's kind of active in the States, but my understanding is, again, that there's these kind of new sorts of practices and societies emerging around Venmo, where people are doing new kinds of conspicuous consumption and sort of showing off what they're paying to other people. So some of these systems are running on, they're kind of riding the rails of publicly mandated money. So things like PayPal, where they're acting as kind of an automatic or a settlement system. So they're kind of settling in the background, and they're just sort of sitting on top of the existing monetary system. But I think maybe some of the interesting other examples that we're seeing of new companies that are pushing into this maybe post-monetary space are companies who are developing what I'd call money-like things. So this is new kinds of tokens or currencies that aren't necessarily directly linked to publicly mandated money, not necessarily linked to dollars or euros. So obviously cryptocurrencies is the most significant example of a money-like thing. But increasingly, there's lots of different examples, like we have kind of Fitbit units being used sort of as a means of payment. So we've got Amazon dollars, loyalty points as a new kind of payment or means of exchange, and airtime, which I mentioned earlier, so phone credit. You're seeing kind of network companies coming forward, producing new kinds of currencies, and in some cases maybe guaranteeing their worth. And these systems work around sort of a very complex personalization or matching of not just sort of economic wants, not just about kind of the redistribution of goods and services, but all kinds of data then is being brought within that matching algorithm. So some of the examples that I was very, very briefly touched on yesterday when we were talking were new kinds of credit scoring. So you're probably maybe familiar, people might have heard of Sesame Scores in China being kind of one good example. So this is a system that's developing new kinds of algorithmic credit scores. Sometimes these are focusing on what industry calls the unbanked, so people who didn't previously maybe have access to credit or access to a bank account. So it's using other kinds of data, aggregating those to produce credit scores. So Sesame Scores are based around, while the algorithm isn't, the machine learning algorithm isn't transparent, it's, you know, roughly speaking, it's based around sort of transactions that people are making on Alipay. So that would be one quite significant data point in there. So potentially your purchase of, nappies versus computer games can significantly impact your credit score. And in turn, these credit scores can significantly impact things beyond even your ability to access finance. So they can also impact your ability to get a Schengen visa, for example, or even your visibility on dating sites, apparently. And you've probably heard, it's been in the news, it's kind of been in tech news in the last year, that China are now sort of using Sesame Score as this model for a new social credit score. And I suppose, yeah, these are, as I said, these programs aren't opaque in any way. So one that I looked at closely was Branch, who are a kind of subsidiary of Kiva, who are a mobile money company who are offering loans, basically small kind of microcredit or microloans to people in sub-Saharan Africa. And they were basically building a business model around smartphone data, so working on the adoption of smartphones there, and using then a combination of M-Pesa data, so the kind of dominant payments platform that everyone uses to be paid salaries and to pay each other and to pay for taxi rides and things like that. So using that data and then coupling it with Facebook data such that your social networks and your, as you see there, social network data, your messages, also your payments and your location, and up to, I think, about 5,000 various different data points were being used. As I said, it's quite difficult to actually, and this is one of the big problems, I think, with these matching algorithms, is it's very, very difficult sometimes to actually access what's happening within the machine learning algorithm. So one technique I was trying to use was going through patents and going through privacy agreements by these different companies. So, yeah, I guess my point would be then that with these sort of matching algorithms, you have this tendency then to produce sort of new kinds of credit casts or new kinds of inequalities or reproduce or further old ones, and that they exhibit maybe some of the qualities that you're speaking about. So one being very complicated matching that we're seeing, as Est Finance, I suppose, is another example, that we're seeing also new kinds of dynamic pricing. So pricing that's very personalized or individualized based on data about you, and also new kinds of attempts to make data a currency and to make data fungible. So one example I was quite interested in was, it's a proof of concept by IBM working with China UniPay to try and, they're trying to develop kind of loyalty points exchange. So they're trying to find out a way of making different kinds of data sets or different kinds of money-like things exchangeable or transferable using a blockchain.
Let me interrupt. I try to understand
I've done
that.
Actually, no.
So I'm smoking. You're not smoking. And I can buy your loyalty points to get a cheaper healthcare. That would be fun. No, it can't be. It can't work like that. Let's say you get cheap healthcare if you don't smoke. No, but you cannot possibly buy that. Okay, it makes a cost difference. Technically, there could be a solution like that. But you need to. I think because there's two different types of data. But one is though to say the loyalty points data that you may transact, but the health data you shouldn't be able.
Oh, I see what you mean. Sorry, yeah, no, I haven't clarified it. So it's not about. I mean, obviously, you have data markets for ways of trying to sell or exchange your data that are working with the same problem of how do we make this kind of data exchangeable for this other kind of data. No, some of these loyalty points, it's more about figuring out how you could use your Starbucks points to buy goods in Walmart, how you could use your boots or your pharmacy points to purchase a flight, how you can use your air mile points to,
I mean, that's the one thing, there's two things. Let's get back to the black box at some point. But the other thing is the, so to say, the biopolitical dimension, if you want so. I'm not very happy with the term biopolitical because it doesn't really describe what happens. What I think is, money helps us now. For nowadays, we're accustomed money to coordinate our behavior. We go somewhere we think it's too expensive, blah, blah, blah. That means we internalize the matching. Or we say, I can afford it. It's a typical internalized matching. Now, with these surfaces that you said, it's like it enters a more detailed structure of how to direct our behavior. And the surface that you're saying, all the graphics, remind you a little bit of computer games. And I think it's my impression that we're getting there from some kind of, let's say, computer game type surface that directs your behavior. And my question is, in the back, is how is the transition from a monetary system, from a money system to a non-money system? And I have the impression it could be even happen in a way that we don't realize it, and that we are already going there. But I don't know. Would you also read it in the direction that, so to say, there is a behavioral layer that is, so to say, is starting to direct our lives and our life decisions, and at some point we don't even realize that there's money in the bag, that there was money.
I think I understand what you're saying. So. That there's maybe a gamification, and I guess this is what maybe I find, if there is a point of contention between these kind of perspectives that we have, is that maybe that this game, there's something problematic about trying to use a game theoretical model to produce more kind of social or commoning behaviors. The quote that kept coming up yesterday from Audre Lorde was that, you know, the master's tools won't dismantle the master's house. And I think maybe what's happening here is that there's a sort of a neoliberal or game theoretical or financial kind of logic underpinning the matching algorithm. So it's very hard to maybe try and create algorithms to encourage new kinds of subjectivity when they're already sort of infected with particular ideas about economic actors who are self-interested and need to be incentivized and need to kind of gamify their behaviors in relation to each other. Does that make sense?
That makes perfectly sense. Actually, I was thinking in that direction when I was at the talk of Lisa Nakamura yesterday. The basic question behind is, okay, do we have any chance or don't we? Can we try to figure out a political solution that turns things in our way as we want it, or can't we? So to say, are we doomed from the very beginning? Because anyhow, there's the neoliberal core sitting in the system, and they are giving us the applications and whatever you want to do, whatever political different solution you think about it, it's too late. Is it that what you want to say?
I guess I'm just really wary of the idea that any kind of technical system, blockchain, algorithm, machine learning, can produce new kinds of social behaviors. That maybe what we need to do is kind of have a sort of a degrowth moment in relation to our monetary systems. Not maybe necessarily thinking about how we're scaling kind of kin communal forms of transactions, but actually thinking about what is inherent to those kind of systems already. So an example I love is in Ireland, so where I'm from, in the 1970s, there was a couple of bank strikes where the banks closed for months and months at a time. And the monetary system didn't actually collapse. So people like publicans and shopkeepers stepped forward and they started guaranteeing IOUs and checks for people. And so there was a kind of a circulation of money based on the fact that a publican, and my dad was actually a publican at the time, would know their customer and kind of know their liquid assets, no pun intended. So I guess my argument is, I don't think that would actually work in Ireland today because there's different kinds of social relationships at play there. Communities are maybe a little bit more atomized. That, you know, if I was to walk into my local pub, and try and get money, that wouldn't work necessarily today. But that there's something in those examples, maybe.
But why shouldn't it work? If you so to say, with the help of some app, you establish a level of trust to your local pub.
That's there already because you know. Okay,
right. Yeah,
Tom
but
down
then
the
you
road
could, then you could even go to more pubs. I mean, let's say we have the level of trust you have your local pub, and your local pub issues an IOU. IOU is actually coming back to your question about money. The money that we're dealing with. IOUs, which means I owe you something, is so to say postponed payment obligations somehow. That's how you create money. So we create money by handing out a credit, and that credit can circulate on both sides. So that your payment, your delayed payment can credit, but also the Forderung, how is it called, the right to get the payment can also circulate. So that's how money is created in the banking system. Not only we could, when one could privatize that. The problem is only that somebody else has to accept it. But if you reach a level of trust, if you extend the level of trust by way of an app or so, you could extend that kind of private money creation beyond your local app, but you could extend it to, so to say, a network of trusted pubs that you...
Which is what, obviously, blockchain and proof of work is trying to do. Is it's kind of acting as a proxy for the trust between people. So you have an algorithm or you have a cryptographic protocol that you trust in instead of trusting in each other. Mm. And obviously, if you want to scale, I mean, it seems to be the best solution to that. And yet, at the same time... I would argue that you're not actually scaling trust as such in those systems.
Well, the trust, there's an intimate link between money and trust is the trust that you're going to pay. And that's the basis.
You trust in the token, not because you trust in the person that you're transacting with.
But I'm wondering, and the deeper layer is the deeper question that I always have is the question, okay, do we need to keep these numbers in the head? Do we need to know that this and that has such a value? Do we need to internalize the matching bias through the value, or is it something that we can get rid of?
So we could move away from a more kind of quantitative form of matching, right, that we're getting with a unit of account to some, towards something that's a bit fuzzier, like we have with social relationships, where, you know, if I babysat my child's friend or my friend's child for like 3 weeks and she didn't ever offer to babysit my child, that after a while I might feel annoyed, that there is some kind of reciprocity there, but it's a bit fuzzy, that it's not like if you know, that it's not a perfect matching, it's kind of a little bit.
Right, okay, and if it would be a computer game, gamified surface, and you would be only the two of you playing, then her karma would sink to very bad rates, no? But if it's a system where lots of people play, she could do something else and stabilize their karma by something else. You wouldn't even know of it. Necessarily, she does the childcare. She does something else, and her karma stays stable. So everybody who's playing games from time to time is familiar with systems like that, because the matching systems and so to say the directing behavioral systems in games all work like that.
So it could be like a time bank, but instead of it being a specific unit of account, it's sort of some way of matching or circulating different kinds of needs and wants.
Well, the unit of, there may need to be a unit of account in the back, but my point is whether it's possible to say, to not internalize that calculation with the unit of account, but rather look at a game-like surface that, so to say, gives you recommendations of what you may best do or not do. Mm? It sounds terrible, but in some ways, that depending how it's done. But I think, and it's anyhow where things are going. It's not what we have much of a choice to enter that kind of system. It's going to come. The question is rather what kind of political possibilities do we see there? Do we want to have that system overlaid over top of, so to say, money tribute system that we have now, or do we want to develop a political perspective for it? And that's, so in the end, it's a political question, I would say, an important political question.
I guess there was one thing maybe that I wanted to touch on, or that we spoke about before, which was maybe anonymity as well, and cash. So these matching algorithms, obviously, they're always they're always sort of gathering or aggregating then data about people. And I'm actually a really big fan of cash, so I really, really love cash. I think it's a really, really interesting technology. And while there's an argument that a dominant argument that we see is that, you know, cash is something cold and hard and impersonal, and that's sort of the argument that Simmel was making, you know, in his theories of money, that sort of since the 70s there's been anthropologists who've come forward and they've looked at the ways in which people are actually really, really creative with money. So even though money is quantitative, that there's a very qualitative relationship to that, and that can be things like gifting. So again, in Ireland, if someone's really stingy, you say he still has his confirmation money, because you get this kind of gift practices happening with money, where you receive a sacrament that everyone has to pay money. And Viviana Zelitzer in particular, who's an anthropologist who wrote this great book called The Social Meaning of Money, has looked at all the different ways in which, you know, people invent new money, create new kinds of meanings. An example I really liked was following the death of Leonard Nimoy, that, you know, people were re-inscribing the Prime Minister's face, you know, to turn him into Spock. That, you know, people have ways of kind of using cash as being something, even though it's controlled by the state, that somehow, because it's this kind of instrument that moves into circulation from hand to hand, that it also moves beyond that control in some way. So another example being this work by Sildo Morel, where he was protesting against US occupation of Brazil in the 1970s and put these political messages on notes and then spent them back into circulation. I'm getting a bit off track. One of the things I think is great about cash that's not great about matching algorithms of any type is that cash is, largely speaking, anonymous. And I'm even thinking back to Peter Sunde's talk in Transmediale a couple of years ago, where he made this point that, you know, we need instruments like cash to remain anonymous. Maybe what we don't need is a matching algorithm. What we need is some kind of informal, unmeasured and unaccounted for forms of behavior.
I agree. No, that's not, not okay. Yeah. The question is whether we can emulate something like cash digitally, or not. Mm. But I think okay, even on a level of finance, you can't deal with cash. So whatever you have, modern finance on the basis of cash would be just impossible. Like the bank of the central bank issuing some IOUs on the basis of cash, forget it. Doesn't work. So, but okay, on the level of the on the consumer level, the Bitcoin could be regarded as an emulation of cash somehow, and that's not part of the solution, but I would rather say it's part of the problem, because on the basis of Bitcoin, there's an, so to say, completely outdated idea of money, like gold, and that's also what renders Bitcoin a commodity. It's actually not money, it's a commodity that is used for transactions. It doesn't work like that, so then there would be, I don't know, how would you try to fix that, to find a solution for a more contemporary type of money? It means IOUs on the basis of, how to say, on the basis of the privacy settings that you need for cash. Is there a possibility? Do you see anything there?
A possibility digitally to emulate. Right. Why does it need to be digital? Because it's transmediale.
Sure, of course. Well, I think there's not much of an alternative for it to be digital. Of course, you could say, oh, no, I want to form a tribe that still deals with cash. But I think, how to say, the technological development doesn't go really in that direction. So it would need quite some hard laws in order to enforce the people keeping the digital. I'm also a fan of digital. I have nothing against digital against cash. No, but I don't see it coming, like practically speaking, so to say, realpolitik. No, we're not going to. Cash may be on the consumer layer surface somehow, be circulating, but anyhow, it's not. When you look at finance, it's not based on cash. So cash is also a little bit of an illusion, but it guarantees privacy to some degree. I agree, but maybe there could be a system that you have on the finance, and for the finance level in the back, you have a digital system. But in trying to look into the future, the question would be, can we emulate a digital system that guarantees privacy and creates a money that is not based on a 19th century idea of money like Bitcoin, but on an IOU based of money, like where the money basis is, so to say, flexible? That's the difference.
Well, I mean, I think now's the time. I mean, there's never been so many discourses and conversations about what money is and what money we want and what we want money to be. So, I mean, I think, you know, there's been, to use Jaramil's phrase, you know, Bitcoin and the financial crash broke the taboo on money. So potentially this is the time to try and imagine those alternatives. I guess my argument is that we also have to kind of imagine the kinds of infrastructures and ownership of infrastructures on which that money rides on as well. And think hard about some of those issues, and they're like the political, as you say, the political values that underpin that.
I mean, now we could come back, and that's actually an interesting point that I took from yesterday. We didn't talk about it because it came up with the Lisa Nakamura talk. How far do the political possibilities that we have to shape such a system go? Or is the system corrupted by the very beginning, by the very fact that it's invented by white male or whatnot? No? I would try to argue that there is, to build on the example of Nishan Shah that he brought, no, with that even measurement, no? And I would say there is a level of neutrality in measurement, and it's on the application layer that things go wrong. Of course, he would argue then both are intricately connected. It's a bit a long discussion, but it actually points to that. I mean, now we're having 15 minutes, so maybe we should go have a look at the questions on the pad, and then open it to the public questions. So, how can an economy function without a currency when capital is an axiomatic a priori? Where will all the money go? You have an idea? Oh, or should I try?
If you want to try. We can also take questions from the floor as well if people... Well,
no, let's go for it, yeah. Now we... Well, I would say... first answer is money, like storing money, is like the rights to future payments. If these rights to future payments are not being fulfilled, they are indefinitely postponed. That's what we're having now. That's where we already are. We're postponing. It's not about paying back credit. It's about, and if credit is money, then look at it from that way. It's about endlessly postponing. That's where the money will go. It's postponing and postponing and postponing. Rolling over the credit and rolling over again. But that's where we already are. That's the state of the present. We're not talking about the future here. That's why all the central banks pour billions and billions every month into the, every year into the economic system. So,
I think the next question is for me. So the systems, I presume it's the systems I was describing, which were new kinds of money-like things. And it's a great question. So someone's saying that there's nothing new under the sun here. There was lots of different kinds of scrip and bonus cards and stamps and different kinds of money-like things, and also different kinds of credit scoring before algorithmic credit scoring. So my argument would be that what's new is, first of all, that there's often a rhetoric around these new kinds of algorithmic credit scoring and risk scoring, that they are more neutral and they are fairer. So Branch, for example, say that this is better at calculating credit than any human could be. So, you know, your history of credit scoring was where somebody actually went around and they spoke to different merchants and they compiled your credit score, often based on what your neighbors even were saying about you and your debts and if you discharged your debt. And there was obviously room for that particular credit scoring actor to make cast aspersions on you based on maybe your gender, your race, your religion, and so on. And the idea is that these are supposed to be kind of neutral ways of calculating risk, but what we're actually seeing is anything but, is that they reproduce those existing credit casts, they reproduce those existing inequalities. So I guess that's sort of the point that, and what's new, I suppose, is just the level of data. So historically, you know, with the, what were they called, Western, I can't remember the name of the credit company in the US that sort of was developing your
credit scoring system.
In the 1920s, so this is way before even FICO or anything like this. So it's a very, very kind of fuzzy system where somebody was writing handwritten reports and they were kept in a sort of a library system that was, you know, it was based on a kind of a small amount of data points about you, whereas what we're seeing, and to some extent they were a little bit more transparent. What we're seeing now, obviously, is the new kinds of discriminations are based on thousands and thousands of different data points, and we don't really understand, I guess, how they're working.
Let's speak of the preference for cash. The preference for microphones. So we're going to go quickly to run to the digital, through the digital questions, and then we go into the microphone section. So, good point. Let's start at the bottom. Who's in control of the matching algorithm? Yeah, good question. We. No, that's the point. That's actually the whole point in the discussion, to raise the awareness that we should be in the control of the matching algorithm. That's why we need to talk about it.
I think that's really, really problematic. So, you know, the problem is that we don't own, you know, that when we're speaking about money, and we're speaking a lot about removing tokens, but Bill Maher has a really nice way of talking about money as a token and a rail, telling you, and the token is the bearer instrument or whatever circulating, the rail is the infrastructures that what money runs on, and that might be social infrastructure, or it can be a central bank, or, you know, as we're increasingly seeing, it could be radio spectrum, information and communication technologies, and we don't have access to any of these things.
Right, because of course there's an infrastructure, but we can raise the claim that this should be a public infrastructure, that this should be politically, this is a political question, if not the political question, because it deals with all our behavior. No?
Yeah.
So. It's a genuine political question. Instead of money, are we just using multiple other numbers? Maybe yes, I would also say so, but difficult to explain how. By the way, the book is going to come out in English, and there is some section on value, multidimensional value ideas. Exciting examples of free money utopias? No, I don't know. You know of any?
I don't know. Does anyone in the audience have any particular examples they like? I mean, I've definitely loads of examples I think is interesting. So I think, kind of Recoin is quite an interesting project. But I don't know if people have. Maybe there's people who are developing examples, or people who have projects that they particularly like.
Well, if there is any norm, please write it to the other pad and answer the question.
We have the crowd here, answer. Actually, I'm finding this kind of weird in that it seems like we're talking.
We should consider the questions now that we made people all have all the questions. The condition for equality is to de-anonymize transaction to make transparent who owns and what and who pays whom. Right, yeah. Is what Stefan describes in any way related to the project Cybersyn in South America in the 70s? No, because it's not a plan, it's not a central planning system in some way in that respect, not in one other respect. Is it in so to say, in the history of technology, application to finance? Yes. At the time, it was we outsourced the answering of the questions. That's the best idea. You just have a discussion there. It's open. At the time, it was only producing matching, but are you getting roots in this history? No. Okay. Will class be obsolete in the disappearance of the monetary system? That's a good question. I think no. How do you ensure personal agency in a situation of this proposed please step in, I'm reading the questions now. In the situation of this proposed all-managing algorithm. I don't get the question really personally. Let's not guess about questions. Are you getting it? You have a...
How do you have agency if you don't understand maybe what's delegating all of these decisions to the algorithm, I guess. And my answer is that you wouldn't.
How does money, new money, work on macroeconomic levels? Oh, that's too many questions. I think we have to go to the microphone section, else we're going, because we have to end in time. There's a screening. So I'm sorry, the etherpad was too successful. So we outsourced the answer of the replies of the question, but we're going to look through it and I'm going to try to give some answers. And I would propose we go to the microphones, to the cash real life section now, and have some have some questions from the public with the microphone. Are there any? Please also raise again questions that you put on the pad, if you like.
Well, they did that already. They did that in Transmediale a couple of years ago, didn't they? They burned Bitcoin.
Sorry?
I said somebody wants us to burn money on stage, but it's already been done.
Okay.
Boring, passé.
Works. Okay. My name is Mike Hollander, and at my opinion, it all depends on the fundamental difference between mobile and immobile goods. So that money is the logic is in the logic of mobility, and that the transaction between more mobile goods, luxury goods, will always go with money. But there are other goods who are in their logic more immobile, like housing, for example. And the political decision will be to get more taxation on the immobile, on the mobile transaction, on the mobile goods, and less on the immobile, which are more necessary for everyday's life.
Okay, we have 5 minutes for questions. So could you phrase it in one phrase? Because we simply don't have the time to discuss details of that type. I'm afraid.
I think there's a question.
There was more.
Somebody.
Me?
Or? Oh yeah, there's another one. You go ahead. You have the mic.
Okay. Hi, thank you. I wanted to ask you about, you mentioned the value storage problem, and maybe you could talk a little bit about this multidimensional money-like things, like an expiration date for money or something like this.
I got very excited by the expiration date idea of money when I first read about it a couple of years ago. So this idea of like demurrage, was an idea that, you know, if you created some kind of expiration date in money, that would move it away from being a store of value, and therefore you would be obliged, instead of storing wealth in some kind of material good or commodity, that you'd have to store it in social relations. So there was this quotation that I came across somewhere that I really liked, which was, "I store my meat in the belly of my brother." I know that sounds really gross, but it also has this kind of really sparked my imagination. So this idea of thinking about social relationships and commoning as a store of value as opposed to commodities as a store of value. I asked Stefan about this idea yesterday, if demurrage was something he was interested in, but you had some strong opinions about why you felt that would not work, or you said it was tried in Austria, for example, and it didn't really work.
The commoning, or...?
The demurrage, so the idea of trying to design money differently so that it couldn't be a store of value, so making some kind of a penalty
The save your sell option.
I
think it would be... We shouldn't try to introduce systems that so to say, are historically way before our contemporary level of finance. So Silvio Excel is something nice that worked nicely for 5 years in a village in Austria. But how to say, it would be a rückschritt, a step back in the development of finance of 100 years. And we simply couldn't govern a global system that we're having with that kind of thing. That's my impression. One could talk about the negative yield rates if it does actually the same thing somehow or reintroduces it. I'm not so sure. Maybe yes, but difficult. And I'm not expert enough to assess that. So there was one question, yeah.
Nouria Roubini has just said that Bitcoin is the mother of all bubbles and it's gone. We already knew about this. It's going to crash. How do you think this crash is going to impact other forms of alt currencies and, in general, blockchain-based technologies and cryptocurrencies and other applications beyond Bitcoin?
Well, there's, I suppose, a massive push at the moment in fintech industries to disassociate blockchain from Bitcoin. So you have the use of distributed ledger technologies as kind of a direct attempt to kind of remove that discourse from Bitcoin. And still, I don't know, I was at a meeting recently where, you know, if a company or a startup is associated with Bitcoin, they can't even kind of get a bank account. So I guess there's a push to try and separate that. I'm not sure in terms of how a kind of speculation on around Bitcoin and Ether would impact other currencies, because in a way maybe it would be useful in that it would take some of the air out of the use of these currencies as kind of stocks or as commodities, and again allow people to imagine how they could be used as money. I'm not really sure. I don't know. Do you have any ideas?
I would fully agree. It's very simple. Yeah. Do you have the question or you wanted to have one? No. Yeah? Yeah, go ahead. Can we have one mic in front here? I noticed you then after. I want to take
Yeah, it was just about like the possibilities of making black money, like in algorithmic structures, or comparing to cash structures, what you think about that? Like,
sorry, I didn't hear. Did you say black money? Is it?
Or? Yeah, like because cash for sure guarantees the freedom to make black money always everywhere for everybody, and yeah.
Is it when you say black money? You mean like black markets or facilitates?
Yeah, I don't know. Maybe the English expression for it. Yeah, to make money uncontrolled money on the side, like whatever.
Oh, what do I think of so that if because it's unsurveilled, that it gives you the possibility to do these kind of things that are extra legal. I think that argument it's always put forward for the by people, you know, who want to kind of increase state surveillance. But I think it's a really kind of problematic way of justifying kind of the increased digitization of money, and also that, you know, there can be aspects of black market economies that are really socially productive as well. Yeah, I guess.
No, I think it's actually important. That's one of the issues that I have with the commons, no? And the idea of the commons. The commons is built on people that deliberately or that want to engage in a fair social behavior. But real-world economic systems have to deal with people that want to hack it, that want to destroy it, that want to take their own profit, that want to tweak it in all kind of ways. And actually, that's very important. These systems have to be open to all kind of attempts to turn them upside down, and they have to be tolerant to that. That's one, I think, one of the most important lessons in order to build up a system. It should allow for something like that, but it should also allow to fight it. But it shouldn't like most, that's always the discussions that I have with the people that talk come from the commoning side, that they take for granted that everybody wants to be nice to each other and then we can share everything. No, real world, unfortunately, doesn't look like that.
I think we have to finish up there because there's a screening going on now. But thanks a million, Stefan, for
thank you for coming and participating.